Chairman, sir, thank you very much. But I have a complaint against Peter for putting me in this lot after lunch and talking about mathematics. I was reminded of one of my sessions in Tanzania. I was addressing a class of 35 trainees. And after lunch, they will have very heavy lunch, mainly non-vegetarian. And then after the lunch, the session will be almost washed out. People will start dozing. So once, out of desperation, I told a fellow was sleeping, dozing, and I told his neighbor, please wake him up. Immediately he retorted, sir, why should I wake him up? You made him sleep, better you wake him up. So I was actually taken aback, and he added some iota of truth in his statement also. Anyway, I will not go into very high technicalities of mathematics, because everybody, I don't know why, they have some fear about the mathematics. I will just try to highlight the contribution of Jinnabhadragani Kshamashraman, a great Shvetambar Acharya of 5th, 6th century, to the Jaina mathematics, Indian mathematics, and world mathematics. Actually, he lived for 105 years, and during which he produced excellent works like Visheshavashyak Bhashya, Bruhat Sangrahani, and mainly we are concerned with Bruhat Kshetra Samas, which is nothing but geography of human world, as per the Jaina tradition, isn't it? I'm taking you back to about 1500 to 1600 years, when the golden era of Greek classical mathematics came to an end with Pappus, Proclus, etc., etc. And it was only revived about 1,000 years in Western Europe. And the Western mathematicians owe their allegiance to Greek mathematicians, whatever it may be. But what about the period? It was called dark period of European mathematics, Western mathematics. But what about mathematics in that period? Yes, in India, a school emerged, a very big school emerged of mathematics, spearheaded by Vedic mathematicians like Aryabhata, Brahmagupta, Varahamihir, etc., etc. And in India, in Jaina mathematicians, just as Sarvanandi, then Jinnabhadragani Kshamashraman, then so many other mathematicians of Jaina school, like they were talking about the Yati Vrishabha, whose contribution is very great. He also talks about the entire universe, and he gives a lot of formulas, various formulas about the universe, its area, its volume, etc., etc., whatever it may be. But what is the contribution of India during this period? The greatest contribution is the system of numerals, symbols of numerals from 0, 1, 2, 3, 9. These 10 symbols, that is the biggest contribution of India, which is recognized by all Western scholars also. And to give 0 its place value, that was a much more important function. We'll see what is this place value, etc. is there. So anyway, the first clear evidence of this, I am not taking credit that Jaina mathematicians did this, but it is sure that the first clear evidence is of Jinnabhadragani, who employed these symbols very easily. He made big, very big calculations with the help of this, etc. So that's why I'm just highlighting his very important contribution. He was so adept, so skillful with mathematics as a student of mathematics today. He could add, subtract, multiply, divide, deal with fractions, calculate square roots of very large numbers, etc., etc. Isn't it? As you know, I'm not going much in detail. The scale, all of us in India know that 0, 10, 100, 1,000, this was a decimal scale, increasing by multiplication of 10. Then 10,000, then what we call 1 lakh or 100,000, then million, that is 10 lakh, then Kodi. Kodi is a very important, that it is 10 raised to 7. That means 1 followed by 7 zeros. And Jinnabhadra Gani, in many of his calculations, goes up to Koda Kodi. That means 10 raised to 7 multiplied by 10 raised to 7 is equal to 10 raised to 14. That is 1 followed by 14 zeros. I am giving you some examples immediately. For example, volume of Lavana Sea, which is surrounding Jambudvipa, of 2 lakh yojan width, he calculates by this 16-digit number. Now, even for me, it will be very difficult to immediately spell out. But he very easily says, it is 10 Koda Kodi, 93 Kodi Saya Sahasa, 39,900 Kodi Saya, 1550 Saya Sahasa. This is place value. Each place, he is assigning some value. That is like a 100 trillion, then billion, and 100,000, etc., etc. This is nothing. Even he tackles a very large number. That is the number of stars in the human world. Now, this also I cannot immediately, if you ask me to read out in the modern term, I am not able to. But he says it is 48 Saya Sahasa, 22 Sahasa, 2 Sayam, so much Koda Kodi. So it is a 23-digit number. It's a very big number, actually. We cannot imagine also. Even as per the modern astronomy, the number of stars in the universe is 10 raised to 23. This comes very near to that, actually. Sometimes he drops the space values, that is, don't say Saya, Sahasa, etc., etc. Simply reads like as we read even today. 1581, here he says, Pannaras Ekkasai, that means 1581, etc. Now, I am coming to his contribution for symbol zero. Very clear evidence is here. Now you will say where he has mentioned those symbols, because his work was poetic in nature. He could not use symbols. But he indicates very clearly that he was aware of the symbol of 0, 1 to 9, etc., etc. How? See, the square of chord of North Bharata, Bharat means our India, North Bharata, chord means east to west span, is the square of that is 75,600,000 kala. Kala means 1/19 of yojan, or 19 kala is equal to 1 yojan. This I will explain you a little later why he uses kala. There is also very, very good reason. And he expresses it that 75, 6, and 8 zeros. So very clear evidence, isn't it? Then square of Mount Himavant, Himalaya span, and its square, he expresses as 105 and followed by 10 zeros. And writes like that in his poetry, in his verse form, that it is 105 with 10 zeros. Square of chord of Nishadha, a mountain Nishadha is, which is identified by so many people with Altai, etc., etc. I'm not going into those details, of geographical details, but it is 32, 2 zeros, 4, and then followed by 8 zeros. And he writes like that, he reads it as 32, 2 zeros, 4, and 8 zeros. This I'm only illustrating that he was very much aware of the symbols of these 1, 9, and 0, etc. Deals with fractions also in a very skillful manner. Nowadays, we write 2 upon 5 by separating a line between 2 and 5. In those days, probably, it was said 2 out of 5 parts and written as 2 and below 5. That separating line was not there at that time. Why I'm saying this probably? Because the Bakshali manuscript, which was found out, and it belonged to the period just nearby to Jinnabhadra Gani, it was mentioned like this. So probably, I say, it was written like this. But he was very adept with the calculation with probably LCM and GCF, etc. Because Aryabhatta employs all these LCM and GCF, etc., of two numbers, three numbers, four numbers, etc., and he was aware of this technique. So, because Aryabhatta was contemporary to Jainabhadra Gani, it means definitely it was evolved even earlier. Friends, Aryabhatta was a great mathematician and astronomer. But there are very strong evidence that he was influenced very much by Jaina school of mathematics. He himself accepts that he was he studied at Kusumpura, near Pataliputra, and Pataliputra was the center of Jaina studies at those times. He uses the terms which are never found in any other Vedic literature, like Utsarpini, Avsarpini, Sushma, Dushma, etc., etc. So there is a clear evidence that he was greatly influenced by. He gave a very correct value of pi, 3.1416. But he always used the Jaina value of pi, which is root of 10, which is slightly incorrect, but he used always that. Brahmagupta also uses the value of root 10, and that's why it is rightly called Jaina value of pi. Pi means the ratio of the circumference of the circle to the diameter, which is a constant. Now see some of the fractions in the last line I have shown. Even such big fractions, he was able to simplify by dividing the numerator and denominator by 12, the first fraction, isn't it? And it was not divisible any further. That was also here ensured. These are prime to each other, these numbers. Similarly, the second fraction also you can see, which he divides by 35, both numerator and denominator, and simplifies it. So this also, he exhibits very high skill in tackling this. Chord of South Bharata, he shows his square root. Now I am coming to square root. Such square roots he calculates. Even today we shiver while calculating the square roots of such numbers, etc. 34, 30, 80, 75, 100. He calculates there. In the fraction also he calculates. 18, 5, 2, 2, 4. And the fraction is numerator this much and denominator this much. And he writes it kalas. And now, just after some time I will explain you why he converts yojans into kalas by multiplying yojans by 19. Because it helps him in calculating. But such big numbers he tackles. Area of Himant, he gives us so much. And there you will see, instead of dividing by 19, he divides by 361, that is 19 square. Because you know, area is length multiplied by width. So yojan and yojan, yojan square. So if it is kala square, we'll have to divide it by 361 to convert it into yojan. So he calculates the area of Mount Himant as this much. another contribution, which is recognized by all the scholars, that is rule of three. It is of Indian origin. Indian origin, that sort of proportions, ratios, etc., on that basis. For example, I have given one example that the Mount Meru of Jain mythology is a 90,000 yojan standing above the ground, with the on the base it is 10,000 yojan, and at the top it is 1,000 yojan. And then there are various gardens on that. At 500 feet high, 500 yojan height, at 33,500 yojan height, etc., etc. And the circumference areas of those gardens are calculated by all acharyas, not only Jainabhadra Gani. It was calculated even earlier in Agamas, etc. And there they have used the rule of proportion. For example, suppose at the height is 1,000. So what will be the height, diameter is 1,000 at the top. So what will be at the bottom. So by rule of three applying, that in 99,000 height, the how much it has decreased. So at any height, they could calculate the diameter of the Mount Meru and the dimensions of its circumference, its area, etc., etc. Because majority of the mountains in Jaina mythology are either trapezoidal or they are like frustum of cone. A cone is slashed, is it? Now, see, there is one big charge against all Indian mathematicians. Western scholars generally blame that your all mathematics was empirical. Like Greeks, you have not gone into the depth. You have not talked about the proof. You have not talked about the generalization. But first time, Jinnabhadra Ganik Shamasraman, or to some extent even earlier scriptures like Anuyogdwar Sutra, etc. But I will say, by stating the formulas clearly, it is Jinnabhadra Gani who first time came to the generalization of various things. For example, pi is equal to root 10, c is equal to pi into d, or for calculation purpose, he says root of 10 d square, isn't it? Chord, AB, chord. What is the is a formula he has given, specifically stated the formula in his work. Similarly, this arc AB, which is called Dhanusha, that also he has given the formula C square plus 6H square. Gives very accurate measurements. Sometimes the error is just 2% or 3% or maximum 5%, but it gives. In my article, which may be circulated to you afterwards, I have given the various explanations how this formula could have been arrived at, etc. But I am not dealing with it just now. But I only want to point out that the attempt of generalization started with Jinnabhadra Gani. Area is equal to C upon 4 into D, and for purpose of calculation, he converts into 10 D4th upon 16 and square root of that. That I am giving you some example. Jambudvip, we say that the diameter is 1 lakh. So its circumference will be 1 followed by 11 zeros, square root of that. And he calculates it as 316227 and this fraction. Now it is, for if the diameter is 1, this pi will work out to 3.16227, while the correct value is 3.1416. But he gives a very near value and he calculates that. This was calculation was given in the earlier scriptures also, Bhagavati, all this, Anuyogdwar, Jiva Jiva, everywhere. But they have not explained how it was calculated, etc. But here, Jinnabhadra Gani explains that how it is calculated. And he, the most important thing, he gives that fraction also. And that fraction he converts into then kosh, yojan, kosh, dhanu, etc., etc. And he gives it that it is 316227 yojan, 3 kosh, 128 dhanusha, 13 and a half, a little above 13 and a half, he says. Even to that accuracy, he goes, angula. Angula. Angula is a very small measure, width of this finger, isn't it? Similarly, for chord of Bharata, he makes the calculation and ultimately he arrives at root of such a big number, 18,5224 kalas, which he converts into yojan by dividing it by 19 and says, it is 9,748 yojan and 12 kala, means 12 by 19, that fraction. Similarly, arc of South Bharata, this South Bharata, I have shown that A to B along the circumference of the circle. Now I'm explaining you why he uses kala. He multiplies by 19, squares it, so it becomes a big whole number. Because if he wants to take the diameter, then he will come into trouble. So he converts into kala and calculates it, this thing. And see, he arrives at the value of this arc of the circle as 9,764 yojan, 1 kala. His error is only of 0.02%. Among 100 yojan, the error is only 0.02%. And you will see that area between two parallel chords. This is his unique formula. Nowhere in any mathematics, Jain mathematics or Greek mathematics, this formula is shown. And there he says that AB and CD are two parallel chords. Why he is interested in this? Because all our mountains are of this shape. In the Bharatvarsha, in the Jambudvipa, all the mountains east to west are of this shape. So he calculates the area as root of C1 square plus C2 square upon 2 into H2 minus H1. See, friends, earlier he has given an incorrect formula, C1 plus C2 upon 2 into height between the two chords, isn't it? But he himself rejects it. He says, no, this is not approximate formula, it doesn't give correct result. And he uses this. In statistics, there is a very important principle that is called root mean square, isn't it? And this shows that he probably knew that root mean square is more than the arithmetical mean. And that is one clear evidence that he himself rejects. No, I will take this. And he calculates the value. I have given this some examples. If we calculate as per modern trigonometry, and if we calculate as per this formula, you will see the error is just very minor. Again, 0.02%. Come to this. Now this, why I'm giving you this example, he tries to calculate the volume of Lavana Samudra, which is surrounding our Jambudvip. And it is said that it is 1,000 deep, it is trapezoidal, and then in the high tide, it rises up to 16,000 yojana above. I don't want to deal with this, because then immediately our scriptures also say, the heretic asks, that sir, if it is so tall, if the whole water will come and it will wash out Jambudvip on one side and Dhatki Khanda on the other side. He says, no, the millions of gods, billions of gods are there, they will come and they will stop the such havoc. Whatever it may be, I am not going into that. But he calculates the surface area of the Lavana Samudra by techniques which are very near to modern calculus. I am not saying modern calculus, wholly and entirely as per modern calculus, but technique very similar to modern calculus. Calculus, we say, is originated with Leibniz and Newton. But even earlier in Western countries in 15th century, 16th century, there were Robert Hall, Torricelli, etc. So they also calculated, but that is Fermat. They actually are the originator of calculus, it is almost recognized, because they adopted techniques, and that helped Leibniz and Newton to carry forward their work. Isn't it? So surface area is also calculated so much. See, there is one boat above another boat. They are facing each other like that. And that, he takes the mean diameter of that, multiplies it by this width, average width, and then he arrives at this. And then to that he multiplies by 17,000 and arrives at the volume of Lavana Samudra, which is such a big thing, which I have given to you earlier. So, now see, square root also. I was also flabbergasted. We are also calculating square root by this method only. But what we do, above we write the divisors. He doesn't write divisors. Then how could he arrive at the answer? The last divisor, 38, 93, 52, he halves it, divides by 2, and that becomes the answer. And then it is also not perfectly accurate. So there is a fraction, and the fraction is the last divisor divided by last dividend. To that extent, he gives the correct answer of the volume of Lavana Samudra. And sorry, Mount Vaitarya. Now, we have talked about in the pre-lunch session about the arithmetic progression, where Ganitsar Sangraha was cited, but Yativrashava also knew AP, GP, that is geometric progression, arithmetic progression. He gives 19 formulas, Yativrashava gives, very complicated formulas of volumes, widths, areas, etc., etc. But even Jinabhadra Gani has given this, has stated the formula in his work, that is about AP, last term is equal to first term A plus number of terms into difference minus difference. That is same formula as what we are doing today. Or the sum of that is N by 2, the number of terms divided by 2 into first term plus last term, etc. And why does this? That as in the morning the example was given of narak, that means lower world. He gives the example of upper world, heavens. There are 12 heavens or 16 heavens, whatever it may be. And in the first heaven, there are 13 layers in which the vimanas, the abodes, or airships of the gods, heavenly gods, are there. And how many are there? He wanted to calculate. In each layer, similarly 13 here. In the first layer, there are 201. In the second layer, there are 205. In the third layer, there are 209, increasing by 4. And he calculates in the 13th heaven, there are 249. So 201 plus 202, he doesn't calculate all, but he just does this. And by using this formula, he says 13th layer, there are 249 airships, vimanas. And how much total? This is in one direction, not in all directions. What is the total? 13 by 2, 201 plus 249 is equal to 2925. This is the total number of vimanas in all the directions. So he was perfectly aware with the arithmetical series. One very important thing, a very important and powerful technique of modern mathematics, number theory, is what is called modular arithmetic, which goes as per, if I ask you that 1 followed by some 20 numbers, what is, how it is divisible? Can we find out what are its divisors, etc.? So for that purpose, this modular arithmetic is used, isn't it? Similarly, he says that out of three abodes, first is triangular, second is square shape, and third is circular. Now, where he uses triangular means, he says, first is, it is written as 1 mod 3. Means if it is divided by 3, it leaves a remainder of 1. 2 mod 3 means if it is divided by 3, it leaves a remainder of 2. And if it is divided by 3, it leaves a remainder of 3 means, again it is divisible by 3, so remainder is 0 only. So this is called, I'm not going into detail, but this modern technique, which is attributed to Gauss of 17th century, he has employed in calculation of this. How? He writes like this. I'm not going into detail. One example only I will give. 62 is 3 into 20 plus 2 into 1. That means if 62 is divided by 3, it will leave a remainder of 2. 2. 61, it will remainder of 1, last term, isn't it? So, doesn't matter, I'm not going into much detail, but see.
Please finish.
Now, what he's done, he sums all this, not just common sum, but he says there are 20 atoms, 3 atoms of multiply by 20, that is 60. 19 into 3, 18 into 3, 17 into 3, 16. You can make it an exercise at your own leisure time. Plus 5 into 2. 5 numbers are such which leave a remainder of 2. 4 are such which leave a remainder of 1. So total 728 in one direction. In 4 direction, 2912. And there are 13 layers, 13 central airships. So if they are added, again the same number which you have seen earlier, 2925. But where he uses this modular arithmetic powerfully is this. How many are triangular? How many are circular, square, and how many are circular? So for that purpose, he uses this technique that earlier we have seen 728 is equal to 3 into 238 plus 5 into 2 into 4 into 1. That means 238 are circular. They are perfectly divisible by 3. Then 5 are such which are not circular. They are leaving a remainder of 2. So they are square shaped. So there are 5 more, that means 238 plus 5, 243, and 4 more are triangular, that is 247 are triangular. So
please,
he calculates
finish
the exact number of how many are circular, how many are triangular, how many are square, etc.
Professor Shah,
by using this technique of, yes?
Professor, please finish. Please finish. Time is over.
Oh, okay. Just 5 minutes.
Not 5 minutes, within 2 minutes.
Okay, I'm finishing. I'm not dealing with this figurative number. The modern technique in number theory, that some numbers can be represented by figures. And Jinnabhadra Gani displays a lot of skill in this also, but I am not going to deal with this because it is not subject matter of my talk today, not about the computational skills. Similarly, friends, one more thing which is a very good area for research in Jainology, in Jaina mathematics, is infinitesimal. Now, today we say we have gone in the earlier lecture from zero to asankhyat, ananta, especially ananta also, ananta, ananta. But what about the infinitesimal, smaller? So Jinnabhadra Gani goes up to 26 stages. We are reminded of modern physics, where molecule, then atom, then electron, proton, neutron, etc. Then they are formed of baryons, leptons, etc., etc. And now we have gone up to God particle, that is boson. And even lesser than that is the quantum length, Planck length, that is 10 raised to minus 44. Isn't it? But Jinnabhadra's calculations are unimaginable. I am not dealing with that. He goes 26 stages down. Each stage is multiplied by, divided by ananta. And this way he goes avadharik sharir, molecule, atoms, ultimate particles, then vaikarik sharir, then aharik sharir, then so many other karman particles are very fine. And this way he goes up to 26. I'm not dealing with this. But this is the conclusion. We can say he's the pioneer in Indian mathematics. Actually, I had discussion with Dr. Anupam ji, where I said, Sarvanandi, who wrote the Lok Vibhag, he also displays all these skills. And he is of same era, about 450 AD, which was composed in 458 AD. But Anupamji pointed out to me that the original is not available. It is available with a translation in Sanskrit of that Prakrit work by Simhasuri. So unless we get the original, you cannot claim this. So I accepted this. So we can say then, as per the scriptures available, Jinnabhadra Gani can be treated as a pioneer of modern computational mathematics. He does it in the most modern manner and exhibits all the skills, very high skills of computation. That's why I have titled it as
Thank
Computational
you.
Wizard of